Hello, my lovely viewers, and welcome. I am Kira, a romantic ace, and tonight we are streaming Chapter 7 of Endless Summer Book 2. And I do want to say thank you to Queen K23 for the follow between last week and this week. Hey girl, how's it going? It's a good Friday night. It's gonna be good. We're excited. We're gonna try to save some lives here. If you haven't joined me before, welcome! I drink and I cuss. If you want to play the drinking game along with me, the rules are right here on the screen, also below the player at twitch.tv/aromanticace. If you cannot read the words in either spot, go to that website, click on the image underneath, and it will take you to my Wattpad, where you can read the most recent version of the drinking game rules in text form. Also, if you haven't joined me before, the story so far, so we are playing as Kira, a college co-ed who won a trip to, all expenses paid trip to a private island resort with a bunch of her college classmates, many of whom didn't know us or particularly like us at the time that we showed up, promptly arrived on the island in the middle of a storm, discovered we were literally the only ones on the island. There was no air traffic control, no one working at the resort, but there was apparently somebody around to set our plane on fire so we couldn't leave. Oh, and there was a flying seahorse fairy and a saber-toothed tiger and a frost-breathing fox and, oh, did I mention the Na'vi? I mean the Watchers, I mean the Vanti, whatever they're calling themselves now. We're in a James Cameron Avatar sequel that nobody asked for. Basically, we're just trying to get off this island, but right now we actually apparently have to collect all these catalyst idols because apparently we're part of this society's apocalypse, you know, narrative from their religion. So that's always a good spot to be. We just defeated, you know, a gigantic sea monster, as you do. And here at the end of it, we thought we'd won. Everything was great. Turns out one of our friends is dying. Her genetic disease is progressing a little bit faster than it's supposed to. So now we have to try to save Quinn's life. So with that, the stinger for chapter 7 is, with Quinn on the brink of death, your only hope to cure her is hidden in a surreal parallel world. Will you find your way back in time? Let's find out! This is Act 5, we're starting Act 5 now, Chapter 7, Everything at Once. We are still at Elistel, which is the Vanti village. You sit on a swaying bridge high up in the Vanti village, and Quinn has just collapsed in your arms. Quinn, you've got to wake up. And unfortunately, she's unresponsive. That's never a good sign. Quinn's slight frame is suddenly heavy in your arms. Quinn! Quinn, no! Crowds begin to pour out of the audience hall following Varen's coronation. Your friends cross the rope bridge to meet you. You know what, Kay? I will not be upset if you drift on back to sleep while you're listening. It's better than, oh my god, your voice annoys me and I never want to hear you speak again. You okay, princess? Oh god, Jake's accent's gonna be really rough tonight, I can tell. Okay, cool. Oh no! It's Quinn! She just collapsed! I don't know! Michelle rushes forward. Easy, Kira. Lie her down. The two of you gently place Quinn on a wooden platform. Michelle takes a moment to check on her. She freezes. You notice her tearing up. Oh god, are we really gonna make me cry again? I just recovered from Perfect Match Monday, y'all. Like, don't do this. I don't have this much energy. Okay. It's her rotterdams. The final stage is a coma. Oh joy. Furball nudges Quinn with his nose, trying to wake her. No, baby. He's trying to help. Baby. No.
I don't understand. She said she still had months to live.
We went through the portal, remember? We've lost 6 months. If it sped things up, then... then she's probably only got a few hours left. I don't understand this, though. So then did we all age by 6 months? Like, is that how that works? Because that doesn't seem like the point of a time portal gun. The point of a time portal gun seems to be to translate you however much time in the future without aging. So why would you make this device if it's just gonna age you on the way through? There's no point. This is stupid. This is actively stupid. No!
The vine that had intertwined with her branches has woefully pulled her down. I grieve for your loss, Catalysts.
Hey, whoa, whoa, whoa! What is this defeatist attitude over here, Ukjal? Not cool. Not cool.
I did not know of her illness. I am sorry.
Well, we can't just give up. What about those plants on the roof of the Celestial? The ones that healed Alistair's cut? I mean, I feel like those are made to heal acute wounds, not genetic conditions, but, you know, it's a start. Those healed wounds. But this isn't an injury. The syndrome's part of her genetic physiology. Yes, thank you, Michelle.
Varin, please! You have to help us!
Varin looks to Ukjal.
There must be something we can do.
Ukjal bows his head solemnly.
There is one possibility, but all of our Elishars, including your mother, have forbidden seeking it.
Yeah, well, guess what? I think it's time to be breaking out the forbidden magic here, my guy. What are we doing? We can say, please, I can't lose her, or you owe us. Huh. I mean, both are true, honestly. So, What would Game Kira do? Game Kira... So here's the problem with please, I can't lose her, is it sets Quinn up as our love interest, which she is not the way I'm playing it. So I think I'm gonna go with, you owe us. We saved your village. Yeah, Craig liked it.
Hell yeah, we did. How about showing a little gratitude?
Okay, you didn't need to take it that far, my guy, but I appreciate the sentiment.
Our people are in your debt. But more than that, you're my friends. We will do everything we can to heal her.
Thank you, Varin.
Go on, Ukjal. As Elishar, I command you. Tell us everything you know.
Legends speak of a crystal of tremendous life energy,
hidden somewhere in the tree of Elistel. Our ancestors called it the island's heart.
Cool, let's rip that out and stick it in Quinn. Let's just go for it. Just...
The heart is responsible for all of the prodigious growth you see around you. Its touch is said to renew all living things.
Cool, this literally sounds like exactly what we need. Let's do it.
Okay, so we find this miracle grow or whatever and give it to Quinn. Piece of cake.
Sure, let's just cut open a gigantic tree, rip out its heart, and, you know, I don't know, stick it in our friend. Sure. So simple!
The Vaunty war chief shakes her head sadly. The heart exists to nurture the tree, not us. The legends warn us never to seek it out.
Yeah, well, we're supposed to bring about the end of the world anyways. This sounds like a great way to bring about the end of the world. Let's just do it.
I'm afraid Saraxa is correct. Its power is beyond what any one individual can command.
Well, just so happens there's 12 of us. Come on, keep up.
Besides, the heart is not of this reality. It can only be found by those who walk between dimensions.
Cool, how do we do that? Teach me in 5 minutes.
Ugh, you've gotta be kidding. As catalysts, it is possible for you to enter that realm, but the journey is a perilous one.
More perilous than saber-toothed tigers and evil Tony Stark? That kind of peril? Because I feel like we're qualified now.
We are not afraid of danger.
Speak for yourself?
It is not mortal peril I speak of, but you may become lost, wandering the veil for eternity.
Cool. Sounds awesome. I'm in. We've gotta do this for Quinn. We're her only chance. I love the fact that Lila just never sounds upset.
No more talk. Where do we find this thing? We must enter the root burrows. There lies your path to the heart.
That sounds like something straight out of the Shire, my guy, but okay. Lead the way.
As Ukjal shuffles off, you pause and look back at the motionless Quinn. You take her hand and squeeze it. Hang on, Quinn. Just hang on.
Somewhat expected, she is still unresponsive.
Varin gently scoops Quinn up in his arms. While you seek the heart, I'll find a proper place for her to rest.
Well, thanks, buddy. That's mighty kind of you, considering, you know, in another future, you killed my lover. It's fine. It's cool. I'm not bitter.
Diego, be careful.
Aw, somebody's worried.
Good luck, catalysts. You will need it.
Aw, I think that's the nicest thing you've said to us. Not to me, you've said nicer things to me, but to all of us.
You follow the old shaman through a series of dark, winding tunnels. Ukjal, how much further? Do you even know where you're taking us?
I mean, probably not, but, you know, it's gonna be a good time.
patience. We are almost... there.
He points with his staff at something up ahead. At the end of the tunnel, a massive tangle of roots blocks the way. Silvery droplets fall from cracks in the wood, collecting in a small puddle.
That's not looking so good. You guys might want to get your tree checked out.
I'm sure they'll take that under advisement, Craig.
To the contrary, the tree is quite healthy. Imbibing its sap will allow you to enter a transcendent state, opening your eyes to dimensions beyond those normally apparent.
That sounds terrifying.
What? Sign me up.
Raj, I don't think they're talking about the kind of stuff you access while you're high, but okay. Raj bustles toward the dripping root. Dude, there's probably, like, a process that you need to put this stuff through before it's safe to drink. Will you calm down for a hot second?
Whoa, whoa. You expect all of us to drink that stuff? No, I really think there should be, like, two or three people who do not drink this just in case. Like, all of us should not be going under. This should be, like, a 3 or 4 person thing at most. The heart is trapped between the world we know and all other realities that converge upon this location. Perhaps you know another way to manipulate dimensional boundaries?
I mean, we apparently flew through one, so if someone hadn't blown up our plane, probably.
Nope.
Furball sniffs the mirror-hued puddle curiously. Mirrors don't really have a color, but okay. You know what? I'm with Furball here. I'm a little concerned. Have you tried drinking it yourself?
Of course, but the sap no longer has any effect on us. Our ancestors were the first to partake of it. Over time, the revelations of the sap changed our people, making us as we are today.
You mean giving y'all blue skin and, like, red eyes and shit? Is that what you mean?
It should still work its wonders on you, however. Or so we must hope.
Cool.
You ready, Kira?
All of your friends share a silent look, and you know they're with you. Aw, shucks. Let's do it. I'll go first. Ukjal untethers a silver chalice from his belt and lowers it to scoop up the sap. Cool, let's examine this, cup that totally didn't come out of the temple in the last crusade. Nope, definitely not. Alright, so we found a clue. It's the silver sap. Interesting. Alright. He offers it to you. Alright, here we go. So, we can take a big gulp, or we can take a small sip. Like with any foreign substance of which you're partaking for the first time, you start low and go slow. We're gonna take a small sip. Raj is not impressed.
Dude, really?
You won't even feel it from that little dose. Some of us don't spend every night toking up, Raj. Some of us have a lower tolerance. Better safe than sorry. Well, at least Lila approves. The sap tastes unlike anything you've known. Simultaneously sweet and bitter. Burning and soothing.
Is it gross?
It's actually not bad, just weird. It's almost like it's everything at once. One by one, you drink from the cup. When everyone's finished, you stand there in the dark, looking at each other in anticipation. Ukjal, should we be, freezing or feeling something? Or freezing, I don't know. Perhaps it may take a moment. The legends were rather vague, to be honest. Wonderful. We don't even know what poison we just drank. I still think not everyone should have done this, but I'm glad you're all in solidarity, I guess. I really feel like Jake should have stayed behind. I don't know why, I just do. Let us return to the surface to consult the ancient texts. Okay. Your friends head up the winding roots of Elistal and out through the base of the tree trunk.
This crap better kick into gear. Quinn needs us to...
Suddenly, your vision shatters into a million facets filled with impossible color, as if you're looking through some sort of kaleidoscope prism.
Whoa!
Alright, that's a new thing. We've had several different versions of, like, traveling through time now, so yeah, this is new.
Anybody else seeing this?
It's hitting, dudes! It's hitting!
You look around. As you turn, the shapes around you spin. The world around you seems to be refracting in an infinite recursion. Oh my god, I would be so sick to my stomach right now. Holy crap. Okay.
Ukjal, what are we looking at?
You turn around and realize the shaman is gone.
I think we're in the space between dimensions.
It's so, we can say, trippy or beautiful. I mean, honestly, it's kind of pretty in here, so I think I'm going to go with beautiful.
I've never seen colors like this.
It's like we're seeing the code of the world. How it all really is under the hood.
I'm sorry. No. I so did not sign up for this wrinkle in time insanity. Yeah, well, we're here now. Too bad, Michelle. I just wanted to spend a few days at the beach, but no, that was too much to ask. I feel like Michelle's taking several frustrations out on this situation right now. I'm just saying, like...
So, what the hell do we do now? The part of the movie where the good guys start hallucinating usually doesn't end well.
No, you see, this isn't good guys start hallucinating. This is like when Thor goes under in Age of Ultron to, like, commune with the All-Father or something, I think. It has been a while since I've seen that movie. But anyway, this is just our, like, really gross kind of racist spirit journey. So, you know, it'll be fine. We're fine. Everything's fine. We've still got a whole other book yet. We can't die.
Agreed. Tread carefully. And Grace, please stay next to me.
I don't know why Alistair sounds so much like the shaman right now. That's weird. Okay, Alistair, I'll keep you safe. Oh my god, Grace, I love you right now. You are adorable. She's so sweet. I love her.
Oh, huh? No, I meant I'd keep you... Never mind.
Yeah, it's okay to need your girlfriend, dude. It's fine.
I don't know what y'all are freaking out over. This is dope.
Yeah, preach. Craig and Zara high five, but their hands pass straight through each other. Ooh, that's new.
What the hell did I just see? Dude, are we ghosts?
I mean, it kind of looks that way.
I'm totally haunting you, Craig. Nuh-uh, I'm haunting you.
Oh my god, we are really gonna have this fight right now. Okay. Your fingers try to touch each other. Their fingers fade. Oh, wow, that made no sense. All right, let's try that again. Your friends try to touch each other, their fingers phasing through each other like liquid. So we can run through Diego, hug Michelle, or prank Raj. I mean, you know, Michelle's having a hell of a time here, so let's hug Michelle. Who wants a hug? Never. Okay, this just became awkward because she literally just said no and we're apparently gonna hug her anyway, which is not okay. You wrap Michelle in your arms and fall straight through her. In the split second that your bodies cross, you feel a strange sensation. As if you briefly embody Michelle, not unlike the visions when you touch a catalyst idol. Interesting. That was... Did you feel... Okay, I was not prepared for that level of intimacy. Wow, yeah, I don't know if we were there, but we are now.
Okay, so... I guess we're ghosts right now, but we can't lose track of what we came here to do, wherever here is.
Right. Find this island's heart thing and save Quinn.
The old man said it was feeding the giant tree, right? It's gotta be somewhere in the city.
Then what are we waiting for? Let's head up and see what we can find. You lead the others toward Elistel's grand entrance. Only to find it barricaded with a high wall of sharp wooden spikes. Guys? I don't think this was here before.
Wow, Lila. Again with the subtle insight.
So, we can keep going forward or search for another way. I don't know, we've been like running through each other, so I feel like we can probably just keep going forward. You step closer to the barricade.
Oh, Kira, be careful!
I'll be okay, I think. You step closer, the wall's jagged spikes inches from your body. You reach out and touch the tip of a spike. You feel its sharp point pushing back. I can do this. You close your eyes and reach out again. This time, your hand moves straight through the wall like a ghost. Excellent. I love it. I'm through! Everybody, come on! We don't just phase through each other. We can phase through solid walls, too.
Sick! Ghost Kira for the win!
Hell yeah!
Of course it worked! Kira's the only one of you not dumb enough to miss it. Thank you, Michelle! That's a very backhanded compliment, but thank you! One by one, your group passes through the spiked wall into the Vontee's Tree City.
We're inside, hooray! Now what?
Now we just have to figure out where this heart thing is. You know, easy. By the way, how much time does this sap give us? Because I feel like there's gotta be a time limit.
Perhaps they can help?
Alistair points. Across the walkway, several Vontee warriors brandishing spears run toward you.
Uh-oh.
There they are!
The Vontee shout in their native tongue, but in your head, you somehow understand them perfectly.
Hey, fellas! Can you give us a hand?
Sure, Jake, you try that. See how it ends. The Vontee raise their spears as they charge.
Great.
Get them!
How about no? Alistair turns away, wrapping Grace in his arms to shield her. Aww. Grace, you still deserve so much better. I'm so sorry. So we can yell at them to stop or close our eyes. We're supposed to be the catalysts, right? Don't we have some level of authority? I'm going to yell at them to stop.
Stop!
And in an instant, the Vontee warriors stop, frozen mid-charge. Not even their eyes move. What just happened? They stopped moving. Not just them. You look around. Everything is perfectly still. The leaves in the wind, the clouds. I think time just stopped. All right, that's weird. What the hell is happening? Why were they attacking us anyway?
Don't think it's us they were after. Honestly, I don't think they could see us at all. Look.
You turn around and see another group of warriors behind you, frozen in time, their eyes burning with hate. And, you know, now just standing there, because apparently we stopped time. It's fine. We just entered an episode of Charmed. We're good.
They're attacking each other.
What the hell?
Why? It was all peace and love 10 minutes ago.
Oh, for God's sake, Craig, be a little genre savvy. Keep up.
The Three Tribes War. The Vonti talk about it sometimes. Like 100 years ago, they had a big civil war over their faith.
The Faith of the Endless?
Yeah. Worshipping the spirit of the island, listening to the Endless's every prophecy, freaking out about Ran Mosti.
All right. He's bringing our genre savvy count back up, so take a drink.
One tribe wanted full theocracy. Another wanted to cast off their religion entirely. It got bad. There was another huge tree city like this. It burned. Those 12 catalyst idols we've been finding? Lost. Scattered.
So that's two tribes. Who's the third?
They're the ones who won. Varin's ancestors just wanted peace. They defeated the leaders of both tribes and forced a truce. Everything sort of just went back to normal.
That's, we can say, good. They need balance. Or pointless. They'll just fight again. Unfortunately, both of these are true. Honestly, if history is any indication, that's pointless. They'll just fight again. You can already see echoes of it. Ukjal and Saraxa are always bickering over the same thing.
Yeah, it's dumb. You don't go for the tie, you play to win the game.
Agreed. You can't let your opponents ever have a second chance. Finish what you start. I don't know. I think it's better that they found a way to live in peace together, despite being so different. Despite having hurt each other so bad. Okay, yes, but here's the problem. They forced a truce. People didn't agree to this. They just basically got told, hey, you're gonna stop fighting now or else. So that's not how you end this thing. There was no compromise. So yeah, they're just gonna turn around and fight again because nothing was ever resolved. That's why. So, we're then? We're in the past? It sure looks like it. It's not just space that's refracting. It's time, too.
And somehow it seems we can control its flow.
You focus your mind, and slowly, time spools forward. Yeah, Alistair, when you say we, you really mean me, so shut up, white boy. In slow motion, the first Vonti group sprints through your ghostly forms and collides with the second, locked in heated battle.
Are you controlling this slow-mo fight sequence, Kira? Zack Snyder would be proud.
Yeah, I could probably do a better Batman vs. Superman than he could, too.
Symmetra!
Did you hear that?
You let time resume at full speed, and hear it again.
Symmetra! Where are you?
Palwan! I'm here, this way!
You look up and see a pair of young Vonti warriors running on a distant platform dozens of feet above you.
The woman in the skull mask. It's her. Queen Zimedra.
100 years ago! What makes us think it's only 100? Where did we get that number from?
Ukjal said that the Elishars had forbidden going after the heart. If they knew something about its power, then...
Then maybe she knows where it is! Come on, let's follow her!
Keeping your eyes on Zimedra above you, you run along the walkway.
Hurry! We've got to keep up!
Overhead, a Vonti glider releases an incendiary bomb.
Uh-oh. Okay. Shit. This is probably going to be a time choice, isn't it?
Here we go.
Nope, not quite yet.
Heads up!
The small bomb explodes. Fire eats away at the wood, collapsing the bridge ahead.
Crap!
You stay calm and focus, willing yourself to...
Reverse time, I think.
Everything instantly reverses direction. The glider flies backwards, warring factions split apart, and the bridge repairs itself.
Hell yeah, Kira!
Good thinking. Keep going!
Soon, you reach another destroyed section of the walkway.
Damn it, we've got no idea when this happened.
Way too far to jump.
Look! Up there! High overhead, an arrow slashes the canvas wings of a glider. The Vonti pilot struggles to keep control as he plunges downward. To avoid crashing, he flies through the gap between platforms.
Alright, so let's freeze time here.
You reach out your hand, trying to grab the moment, and time freezes once more. The crashing glider is suspended precisely between the two platforms.
Hell yeah, we are good. I like it.
Sick! Kira got us a stepping stone!
Nice reflexes, Kira. I'm a little impressed.
Oh, are you now? Are you, Estella?
Yeah, you are.
Just a little? Be honest.
Okay, maybe a lot.
Hurry, Palong!
Continuing on, you keep your eyes on Zimedra as she leads the other warrior along a catwalk.
Kira, wait!
You look down and realize Sean stopped you from running straight off the end of the platform.
Ooh, okay.
Oh, this path doesn't go any farther.
We've got to find a way up to the next level.
You all look around for anything helpful, when your eyes focus on a thin young branch of the great tree sticking up out of the bark.
Guys, I have an idea.
I should accelerate time here, I think.
You focus your will on speeding up time. And soon, the small young branch begins to grow.
Ha ha! Quick! Grab on!
Everyone grabs hold of the branch as it extends out and up, swooping you toward the higher platform.
Cool, this just fast-forwarded us by like years, so now we're gonna have to go back. That'll be fun.
Oh dear!
of course Jake's having a good time.
Woohoo!
You let go and land on the upper level, dusting off your hands.
Nice job. Now,
where were we?
Okay, so yeah, we're going to. You concentrate and rewind time back to the war. Everything races in reverse. Then, young Zimedra is standing right there in front of you, talking quickly with her companion as civil war rages below them.
Do not lose hope, Palon.
But the Faithless are trying to destroy all the Catalyst idols! What if they find the island's heart? What if they...
Do you really think the heart from which this great tree blossomed could be destroyed by Banti hands?
No.
It remains beyond our realm. It existed long before us. It will be here long after our people are gone. We must focus on what we can protect. Our people.
Zimedra opens a satchel on her hip and reveals a Catalyst idol that looks like a hula dancer, which is interesting.
You have one of the 12. Are you handing it over to the devout?
No. It is too much power in either of the tribe's hands. It must be hidden.
I entrust that mission to you, Palon. Keep it safe, somewhere nearby.
And what will you do, Zime?
Zimedra hands the idol to the warrior, then draws a broadsword of obsidian.
I will bring an end to this.
Zimedra leaps down to a lower platform and rejoins the fray. Palwan darts off, nervously.
He's taking off with the idol!
Alright, what do we do? So, we can go after the idol for 12 diamonds, or let him go. No, we need the idol, so we're gonna go after it. You and your friends jog after the Banti warrior until you see him stop. He looks around for anyone watching, unable to see that you're right beside him through the interdimensional veil.
No one else knows about this alcove. It will have to do.
That's a lousy hiding spot, but okay. He brushes aside a layer of moss and vines to open a small hole in the tree's bark and stashes the idol inside before running off. Grace reaches for the idol. As her hand approaches, time warps around her and reveals a solid sheet of bark.
What? In the present, the opening must have grown over. The idol's trapped!
Grace, we were just walking through walls. You can still reach inside. Tentatively, Grace reaches forward. Her hand disappears into the tree and emerges holding the idol.
Look! I got it!
She hands you the idol, and the moment it's touching both of you, in a flash, you find yourself in a classroom back at Hartfold. Professor Diaz adjourns the biology class, and Grace hurriedly packs her things.
I've got just 3 minutes to get to Econ 203. Then TA office hours for quantum mechanics. Before I have to meet with my group for our engineering project. Oh, I hope I make it.
She gets up and rushes for the end of the row when... she bumps straight into Alistair. Oh, I'm so sorry!
It's... all is forgiven. I just wanted to... here. You dropped this.
He hands her a pen engraved with the name Grace Tamara Hall. My pen! You found it! I lost this weeks ago!
Right. I found it just now. I wasn't holding on to it for the right moment or something preposterous like that.
Alistair, did you steal her pen? Because this sounds like you stole her pen.
What I mean to say is you should keep better track of your things.
Mm-hmm. Asshole.
I will! Thanks, gotta go!
Oh, thank you for the follow, your ZFN, your QZFN? I'm not sure how you pronounce that, but thank you.
Oh, very well then.
Grace is darting down the staircase when she sees a crowd gathering around the front of the room.
Diaz graded our papers! Come get them!
Grace wriggles through the crowd and takes hers. She looks at the red markings circled on the front page.
B plus. I know you can do better than this. Wow! What a jackass move on the part of that professor. Seriously. Like, you don't fucking shame your students for their grade. Like, no matter what the grade is. Because you have no idea what circumstances went into why the student got that grade. And I've taught at the college level, so... yeah.
B plus? Can't be!
How'd you do, Grace? An A as usual, I guess.
Look how everybody knows each other except for us. This is weird. Grace stuffs her paper in her bag before Sean can see.
Sorry, can't chat. Gonna be late for econ.
Man, what I'd give for your 4.0. Congrats!
Okay, I just want to point out one B-plus on one assignment does not necessarily trash your 4.0 before we see Grace freak out about this. Just quickly. Grace hurries out of the classroom and rushes across the empty quad. Her professor's words echo in her head.
I know you can do better than this.
Just... mmm! I have problems with that.
What am I gonna tell my mom? I should just be honest, right? She has to accept that I'm not perfect. That I'm never gonna be her. That I'm never gonna take over the company. That I'm a... disappointment.
Hot tears flood her eyes, blinding her. She squeezes her fists, fingernails digging into her palms. Then she sees it. Professor Diaz's car, a modest sedan resting in the parking lot. Oh my god, his dead body's not gonna be inside or something, is it? Ooh! Ooh, Grace has her angry eyes on. Ooh, what is this gonna look like? Grace drops her bag and picks up a temporary signpost from a nearby construction zone. Oh god, what? First of all, you never drop your bag on a college campus, and second of all, what? She smashes it into the hood of Diaz's car. Oh my god! Holy crap! You know I can do better? You know I can do better? She smashes the trunk, the side view mirror, the door panels. I'm gonna take a wild guess Diaz isn't in this car. Okay. Well, I can't, okay? I can't do any better! Ah! She throws the signpost. It punctures the windshield, shattering the glass. The noise snaps Grace out of it. I am impressed if she can throw something hard enough to literally puncture a windshield, because that is almost impossible the way they're designed. Like, it has to be a very sharp, very massive object going at very high speed before that happens. That's pretty impressive. Oh my god. Oh no, 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 what have I done? I have to turn myself in. But then what'll my mom say? She'll... Grace feels her hand scoop up her bag. She feels her legs take off at full sprint. She runs. She doesn't know where to. She doesn't know how far. She just runs. The next day, Grace is sitting in the library studying, but all she can think about is what she did yesterday. And, you know, she doesn't look proud of herself. She can hear whispers nearby. Yo, Zara, did you hear somebody totally wailed on Professor D's ride? Was it you? Pfft, I wish. They don't know who it was yet. Someone taps Grace's shoulder. Hey, Grace? There are a couple cops here. They want to talk to you.
Uh-oh.
Huh? Yeah, what do they want? Did you see who banged up Professor Diaz's car? Yeah, I guess I did. Grace walks toward the pair of police officers. One of them holds something small and silver, an engraved pen.
Uh-oh.
Written on the side, Grace Tamara Hall. Yet again, you're hurled through time and space. Suddenly, you're on a ledge overlooking the magma chamber of Mount Atropo. Grace, hurry! What are you waiting for? You said you could do it! I can! At least, I think I... Grace delicately explores the wiring of a small electronic box. On one side, a red LCD timer counts down. 00058. 00057.
If you don't hurry up, Rourke's bomb is gonna kill us all!
Stop it.
Heavens, will you all shut up? Grace can do anything. She'll get us out of this.
Okay, all of y'all stop putting so much pressure on poor Grace, okay?
I...
You can do this, Grace. I know you can do this.
I can't, okay? I can't do it! I can't be what you want me to be!
mean to...
I can't do better! Grace picks up a rock and smashes the bomb, over and over.
Okay, well, that is one potential method of defusing a bomb. I'm just saying.
Grace, stop! I can't do better!
She bashes the device one more time. The bomb clicks. The display skips to 00000.
Uh-oh.
Oops.
Boom!
Okay, then. All right.
The world whites out. When the blinding light fades, you find yourself looking into Grace's eyes.
We found another one, Kira! Isn't that wonderful?
I hate the fact that we're the only people who know about these things.
Alright, so that is what, 7 now out of 12? Cool. Cool, cool. Yes, 7 out of 12. Okay.
This is all well and good, etc., but we are still no closer to knowing where the heart is.
Hey, one thing at a time. We literally have all the time in the world until our weird, you know, hallucinogenic dose wears off.
No, but we know when it is.
Zimedra did say that this tree grew from the heart, right?
We just have to rewind time to when it first started to grow. Easy for you to say, Lila. You're not the one doing the rewinding.
A tree this big? We're talking thousands of years, at least.
Yeah, damn right we are.
Everybody, hold on. I'm taking us back. Time begins to reverse, the sun moving backwards across the sky. War reverts to peace. I'm gonna keep going.
It's getting faster!
The buildings around you are deconstructed. The city of El Estel slowly retreats down the great tree's flank. And we're going to keep rewinding. Time races faster. You catch a glimpse of disheveled people in tuxedos and gowns roaming the rainforest.
Whoa, check it out! Humans!
And we're going to keep rewinding.
On the horizon, enormous container ships sail towards you, their hulls emblazoned with a swirling logo.
Rourke International. Those are my father's shipping vessels.
Okay. Gonna keep going.
Soon, the sea is on fire. At the horizon, a Venezuelan oil tanker is cracked in two, its black blood spilling forth. Nearby, an American destroyer exchanges torpedoes with a trio of German U-boats, and fighter propeller planes dogfight overhead.
Oh, World War II. This has got to be the Battle of the Caribbean.
Gonna keep going, because that's only about 100 years. The world moves even faster now. The epileptic flashing between day and night becomes a steady dim light too fast for your eye to catch. The sun and moon side by side in the sky.
pirate ships swarm the bay before you. The manor on Sharktooth Isle unbuilds itself.
Those must be Yvonne's peeps.
Gonna keep going. The large galleons give way to narrow oared canoes covered in palm leaves, beaching themselves on the sands.
This must be the Mayan explorers. We've got to be around 1000 AD now.
Let's go, Kira! Faster! I mean, you heard the lady, let's keep going. You focus. Everything blurs. The island's very coastline fluctuates, warping in tidal erosion. And finally, the colossal tree of Elistel begins to shrink. Just gonna keep going! Elistel continues to shrink away. Now it's a normal-sized tree.
Keep going.
At last, the mighty tree is a sapling, shorter than you.
Now!
I'm gonna keep going. But you keep going. The tree slips entirely into the ground.
What in the heavens are you doing?
It grew from the heart. We can't just, like, stop while the tree is still there, dude.
There's something I want to see.
You watch as the sea to your north grows darker and colder. Glaciers encroach. Snow piles around your legs as the Ice Age claims La Huerta. You catch a flash of a saber-toothed tiger prowling the dead land.
Gonna keep going!
Still, you keep going, diving deeper into history. I mean, at this point, why wouldn't you?
Where are you taking us?
The beginning. The island shrinks away beneath your feet. Lava pours up the slope of Mount Atropo, back into the withering volcanic cone. A pterodactyl flies overhead, like you do. And let's just keep going. The island is now just the small, smoking tip of the volcano peeking over the waves. You float in the warm, prehistoric water. Cetus swims nearby. Oh, cool. Sea monster. Yay! Just hanging out. Again, like you do when you're a sea monster. Apparently, you know, a few billion years old. Well, a few million, sorry. You can stop or keep going. Keep going. And at last, the volcano is entirely gone. You stop the rewind. Yeah, on the purple screen, of course we do. All of you are underwater, feeling the currents dance around you, yet somehow able to talk and breathe. I love it, don't question it. How far back did we go? My best guess, based on the life forms we saw? 200 million years. So what you missed, Risa, was we dosed ourselves with some hallucinogenic sap, and now we're, like, walking the interdimensional veil between times to find the island's heart, which is the thing that the tree of Elistel grew from, and is probably the only way to save Quinn's life. We're not supposed to be doing this, but because we're the catalysts, we It is possible. And we found Grace's catalyst idol. And found out that she kind of vandalized her professor's car when he was a jackass on one of her grades. So yeah. Now we're rewinding into prehistory. It's a good time. You let time drift forward. Everything is peaceful, quiet, and then... That's always good. Whoomp! Far below you, an enormous fissure instantaneously opens in the ocean floor. Oh god, that would be one hell of a shockwave.
Ha! What is that?
Blinding red light from the Earth's mantle shines out, rippling in the depths. This has got to be it. The beginning of the island.
But how? What? How did that happen? There was no quake, no plate movement?
Sometimes those tectonic plates just kind of go snap about like that, so I'm not that surprised. But it's a clue, the deep fissure. So we've already found 2 out of the 8 clues.
Grace is right. This doesn't seem natural.
What the hell?
Come on. Let's get back to the birth of the tree. That's when we'll be able to see the heart. I'll get us there. Well, until now, we've been the only ones doing the driving, so I didn't realize other people could drive. That's interesting. Estella concentrates. Time blurs around you again until...
Now!
Estella stops time. Everyone falls silent.
That's gotta be it, right?
Cap, for once I think you're onto something.
Before you is a small nest of bone-white roots. Encased inside it is a brilliant light, brighter than any you've ever seen. Even in full daylight, you have to shield your eyes. It's so beautiful. You found it, Estella! Now we can save Quinn!
Yeah, but how are we supposed to get it? We know where it is now, but what about in the present?
But Raj, we do know where it is in our time.
Oh, good. Wait, we do?
I think Grace is being a little genre savvy over here. Take another drink.
Did you see those bone white roots the heart was surrounded by?
There's only one place we've seen those in El Estel. And that would be the throne room. Oh, I have to click on my thing, hang on. You're right! The throne in the audience hall is made of those same bone white roots! My god, she's going back into tour guide mode. Help!
At the very center of the tree. It's a logical conclusion. Well reasoned, Kira.
Thanks, I wasn't looking for your approval, but sure. Well reasoned is my middle name. Which is hysterical because we actually don't know what our last name is. The game's never told us, so... Do we have a last name?
Who knows?
And I thought my parents hated me.
I mean, Everett Alistair Rourke III is
or Junior? Is he the second or the third? I forget. Either way, it's pretty bad.
Come on, then. Let's get back to the present and grab the heart.
It just sounds so violent. You set time fast-forwarding. A sapling grows out of the nest of white roots, then into a small adult tree.
Grab on, just like before!
Everyone crowds around the young tree, climbing up its branches as it streaks skyward.
Whoa! Hang on!
Everything you'd seen plays back at super speed. Soon, the tree reaches full height, and you watch as the city is constructed below you.
We're back! Let's go!
You run over to the throne room, phasing through its heavy wooden doors. Inside, the prism effect is stronger than ever, the room seeming to repeat infinitely.
Oh my god, I seriously would. I'd be so nauseous. I'm not even kidding.
Oh. This is kinda making my head hurt.
Hang on, we're almost there.
The throne sits in the center of the room. An extra-dimensional light beams forth, shining through the roots.
There it is.
You kneel before the throne and reach forward. Your hand passes through the roots, and you feel your fingers close around something.
I feel it!
What you're touching feels like everything at once. Rough and smooth, burning hot and freezing cold, round and sharp. You pull your hand back, and it emerges holding a ball of pure white light.
I've got it!
What's it doing?
Its light intensifies, engulfing everything.
Whoa!
In the blinding light, Jake takes your hand. Because of course he does. He's so dramatic. Honestly. Like, you would think that character would not be this dramatic, but he is very dramatic. And it's kind of funny.
You still with me, princess?
You grit your teeth, wincing against the light. It bathes you completely. And finally, it fades away. The audience hall is back to normal. Everyone stares at the heart in your hands, a pulsing ball of pure light.
Astonishing! I didn't think you had a chance of... I mean, well done.
Stick around, Jumanji. Nothing's impossible when Kira's on the job.
Aw, shucks, he's got faith in us.
You notice Saraxa standing watch over Quinn in a secluded corner of the hall.
Okay, we recovered the heart, what now?
Ukjal delicately takes the heart from you and walks over to Quinn. Its pulses grow stronger as the shaman places it beside her head.
And she's just still laying there, unconscious.
Now,
We wait. And hope.
Ukjal lowers his head in prayer. Saraxa hesitates for a moment, then follows his example.
Wow. Okay. All right.
Dudes, I think I'm gonna need some fresh air after those shenanigans.
Pair that with a drink or three and you got yourself a partner.
The group begins to file out of the room. Zara remains in place, staring at Quinn.
Aww, she's so upset.
Yo, 404.
Servers go down or something? Oh, she really is upset. Oh.
Come on, you haven't made fun of me in like 5 minutes.
Oh, he's trying. Bless his heart.
Or maybe you're just too lame to think of a good burn. Ha!
Craig, honey. Oh.
What? No comeback?
No, you've got to try something different, boy. No.
Zara turns around, and you see an incredibly pained expression on her face. She marches out of the room.
No, because she doesn't want to cry in front of everybody. Oh.
I feel you, Zara. I got you, girl. It's okay.
Huh?
We should check on her. Zara is at the opposite end of an adjoining catwalk by the time you emerge from the hall. She leans against the railing, her gaze falling to the sandy beach below.
What did I do? She's never like this.
You should go talk to her. Like, actually talk about what's on her mind.
Yeah, Craig. Feelings. You will have to talk about feelings. It's okay.
But, I don't know. I don't know if she wants to get real like that. At least, not with me.
Aww.
Of course you're gonna make me pay for it. Craig, we can say she needs you right now. Or, never mind.
Okay, this sounds like we're gearing up to be somebody's therapist, so take a drink.
I'm a sucker. Craig, she needs you right now.
You're right, bro. I'm being a wimp.
Yeah, the never mind option. Yeah. What the hell, you guys? Ugh. Yes, you're going to have to access emotions. Okay, y'all better not make me cry. I mean, I feel like I'm better after Monday, but who knows? We're gonna find out.
Craig wanders over awkwardly and sits beside Zara.
So, that was pretty wild back there, huh? Go away. Yeah, that's what I thought you'd say. Thing is, I
It's not fair.
Huh? What's not fair?
All of this. Quinn's only ever been kind and generous and giving. She's so freaking perfect and pure, it's annoying. And look what happened to her. Look at her luck. And then there's me. Why am I the one who's alive?
Oh, honey, you can't do that to yourself. Come on, you're not all bad. I mean, I saw you pet a puppy once.
Wow, that's the best you can do? You jerk! Oh my god! Terrible!
I'm a jerk to everyone and you know it, Craig.
She said as if to prove her point.
Okay, yeah, that was after you fed it a snail.
Ah, poor puppy! Oh my god! No! Craig, you're not helping the situation!
People like her shouldn't be struck down by life while people like me coast by.
Okay, but, like, that's why we're not the ones making those decisions, I guess?
When the rules are rigged, you walk away. That's how I've always played.
Yeah, it's harder to do that with the game of life, though. Craig and Zara fall silent. You notice Tari leaning out of a window nearby. He spots the two of them and comes running up. Giggling, he wraps his arms around Zara.
Yee, cute child.
Zara!
Oh my god. Oh no. Okay. What the... Little brat.
I missed you!
No! It's too cute! Where's Furball? This is the only way this can get cuter.
Zara frowns, but ruffles the Von T child's hair. She sticks her tongue out at him. Now go play, Squirt.
Bye-bye!
Oh my god.
Tari scampers off. At least there's one person whose life I bring joy into. More than one.
Oh.
What? Yup. I think that shaman dude has the hots for you.
Oh my god, Craig! Craig, no! Craig! That is not helpful.
She playfully shoves Craig.
Careful! You don't want to go 1v1 with me, noob!
But seriously, look, life isn't fair, but that doesn't mean it's rigged. It's like in an RPG. You can level yourself up as much as you want, but in the end, some things come down to a dice roll.
So I've been told.
In football, you can train hard, come in with a rock-solid game plan, then the ball bounces the wrong way, and it's all over.
But is that gonna stop you from playing the game? Hell no. And if your luck goes south in Gods and Warlords, what do you do? You prepare for the worst, make the most of your chances, and work your ass off to keep your team together.
Ha ha! That's what I'm talking about!
Craig and Zara do a complicated multi-step fist bump handshake combo. Oh my god, yes.
I love it.
Haven't done that in a while.
You still remember it?
Oh, come on, Z. Of course I remember it.
Aww. They quietly stare at the moon together, side by side, until Zara rests her head on his shoulder. Y'all. Am I good or am I good? I'm good. Mission accomplished.
What made you come over here anyway?
Oh wow, 4 points, damn! And I'm still not friends with him.
Kira convinced me. I thought you were just gonna punch me.
Zara looks over her shoulder and sees you watching. You quickly avert your eyes and pretend to be looking at the stars. We are not convincing at all.
Well, there's still time for that yet.
You leave them there on the bridge and head back inside the Grand Hall. You return to find the room empty. Dun dun dun! Hello? Quinn is nowhere in sight. Huh? Where'd they go? Ukjal peeks out from behind the throne.
Catalyst! Run! Save yourself!
That doesn't sound good at all. A hovering figure descends from the darkness above. Oh, hi, Quinn! How's it going?
Where is it?
Each word sends a shockwave through your body, causing you to fall to your knees.
Oh god. Quinn? Where's what?
Quinn cradles the glowing heart in her hands. Her eyes crackle with green energy. Well, I mean, I guess the Green New Deal worked.
The other half!
Cool.
What have you done with the rest of me?
I don't know. Oh, cool. Okay, so... awesome. So that is chapter 7 done. We found both clues in the chapter and the Catalyst Idol. Yay! I don't even know if I tagged this stream. I didn't even look. Oh well. Cool! So, that is the end of chapter 7. We can restart or continue on. I will pick this back up next week. So, same time, same place, twitch.tv/aromanticace at 7 p.m. Pacific on Friday for Endless Friday, where we will find out apparently what we did with the other half of Quinn. Who knows what that means? Yeah. And then this coming Monday,
tune in for Perfect Match Monday. So that is also same time, same place. twitch.tv/aromanticace at 7 p.m. Pacific. I won't have my new microphone for that, but I think I'm supposed to have it before next Friday. I think I have to look at my shipment information, but I think that's when it's supposed to get here, which would be nice so that I stop hissing your ears out every time I say an S. So tune in for that. Where are we in that? Oh, right. Blocked it out of my memory. Because Dames died. Or got his brain reprogrammed. It's basically death. That, you know. It was murder without killing the body, which I'm not sure is any better. So, tune in to see how badly we get our asses kicked in Eros's Tokyo facility. And whether any of us make it out, and whether we can ever tell ever again whether our friends are actually our friends, or if we're all just slowly being replaced by replicants. So that'll be a good time. Tune in. It really is more fun than I make it sound. So tune in for Blade Runner Genesis on Monday. Enjoy whatever it is you do between now and Monday. If you celebrate Easter, happy Easter. If you celebrate, forget what the name of the festival it is that Easter basically tried to replace. Then enjoy your celebration of that. Passover is, you know, going on too. So happy Passover to everyone who celebrates Passover. If I missed your holiday, I'm very sorry. I tried. Enjoy Estra. Thank you. I think I'm saying that right, Risa. Risa prompted me on the name of the festival. Thank you. Enjoy whatever it is you're going to do between now and Monday. Catch you later.